Michael Allen Jones, born November 18th, 1981, also known as Mike Jones.
I'm Mike Jones, Mike Jones.
In the late 90s, early 2000s, the South was beginning their takeover of the rap game. Atlanta was bringing the party anthems and dance and had everyone snapping, whether publicly or in private. New Orleans was bringing its flavor on a more gangster, rugged tip, while still making the room shake in hip-hop. Then there was the other southern juggernaut, Houston, Texas, that was introducing the world to its sound, drugs of choice, lingo, and style. Like every era in hip-hop, the peak is always the most eye, and in this case, ear-catching. Around 2004-2005 was the peak of southern music for that stretch of time, and Mike Jones was at the forefront, kicking down the door for the new wave of Houston artists. One of the reasons he rose to the top was because of his rags-to-riches story and catchy marketing strategy that had everyone participating. 281-330-8004 was the most popular phone number maybe ever in hip-hop, that if you were listening to hip-hop music at the time, you've dialed it at least once.
Hey, what number did you call? You know what I'm saying? Because, you know, a lot of people don't believe that this is really my phone number. You know what I'm saying? What number did you dial?
281-330-8004.
Did I pick up? Already, you already know what it is, man.
It's a number Mike would post everywhere he could in a time without social media. T-shirts, flyers, tour buses, and especially in his music. An idea he got from his grandmother that made him stand out from other Southern artists, along with his video game sounding voice, repetitive flow that, whether you liked it or not, stuck in your head, to which at any given moment you could possibly hear someone yell out, "Who? Mike Jones." Let's talk about how he could have been one of the biggest Southern artists ever in hip-hop, but for these reasons, didn't quite reach those expectations. Salute to JBM Razor on IG for this request. It's your boy JC Stunted Growth. Ash, get it, man. Previously known as Sashay from the underground group South Folk, he dropped out of high school and began pursuing music more seriously. Taking odd jobs at fast food restaurants and cell phone companies helped keep him hungry and was secretly building his image and brand. Jones always wanted to be an entrepreneur and got that chance with his very own label called Ice Age in 2001 and started to promote himself as a solo artist. He caught the eye of Swisher House A&R T. Ferris after relentlessly pushing his music in the city, and his buzz began to build. Stunt number one, label dropped the ball. After signing to Swisher House under Jive Records and Warner, Jones dropped his first single, Still Tippin', with Slim Thug and Paul Wall, and it began to catch a wave in the city and eventually went nationwide. Soon after, the visual came and Mike Jones became a household name. At this point, the label was moving as supposed, and everyone wanted to know who Mike Jones was. The song reached top 60 in the US Billboard charts and 14 for rap songs, later going platinum and making way for his second and biggest solo track back then, that peaked at 22 in the US and 6 for rap songs. It went platinum before Still Tippin' did, and is a staple Southern song for any era in hip-hop. As repetitive as it was catchy, that song took Mike into another stratosphere and set his first solo album up to be heavily requested and awaited by hip-hop fans who were hooked onto the Southern wave, more specifically, the slowed-down, screwed-up sound. He released his debut, Who Is Mike Jones, as a nod to the people back then that made fun of his irrelevance earlier in his career, and in less than 2 months, the album went platinum, eventually going double platinum. Mike Jones had left Jive and signed a distribution deal with Asylum, who would be the worst thing to ever happen to him musically. Throughout his time working with them, they continued to market and promote him incorrectly as he dealt with numerous beefs with the label over splits, release dates, and song choice. You'd think after an artist just dropped a double platinum album, one of the biggest songs in the country, and in an era waiting for more from the South, the label would quickly move on dropping a follow-up album and capitalize. But because the label and Jones couldn't see eye to eye, it caused Mike to hold on to his best songs for an opportunity to drop them later when he had more control, and also caused the label to push the songs that they liked, disregarding the vision their platinum artists had for his music. Songs like Mr. Jones, that wasn't intended to be a single, according to Mike, was pushed and didn't exactly capitalize off the buzz his previous music created. The song became most famous for Lil Wayne remixing it for his Drought series, and even though it charted at 92 on Billboard, it clearly wasn't going to drive him to similar success like his first album did. Because of lack of hype for his second album, The American Dream, the label changed it to an EP in order to contractually control Mike while trying to save face for their artists. And maybe their biggest fumble was the EP releasing more than 2 years after he went platinum with Who Is Mike Jones. By then, his buzz, along with his fans not being happy having an EP instead of an album, all but threw his career off and pushed him off the top of the Southern Music Mountain just as quick as he got there. He began releasing more music to try and keep the fire he had, and it almost worked. Singles like Drop and Gimme 50, Cuddy Buddy, and Next to You all made the top 100, but the time once again between buzzing songs and album release were too much for Mike to keep that buzz, and on April 28, 2009, 2 years after dropping the lead single with Hurricane Chris for his official second album, The Voice, the album released and was a huge disappointment on the charts and with fans who almost 5 years after knowing who Mike Jones was and that they wanted his music, they lost interest, and Mike became old news. He wouldn't release another album as he targets 2021 for the release of his third album, Where Is Mike Jones? Because of back and forth with the label legally, by this time, I don't think the masses care who or where Mike Jones is musically. Stunt number two, the sound of music changing. Asylum was literally the biggest drop of the ball by a label of the 2000s, leading to a promising Mike Jones, who was supposed to have had at least a career Jeezy had, dropping duds as singles, EPs as albums, and falling from the top of hip-hop to back underground, literally. From 2010 to 2013, Mike was nowhere to be found, as he was still fighting with Asylum while wasting away somewhere, lifting weights, and eating Subway. In the span from he first became hot in 2005 to 2013, he dropped two albums, spaced as far away as possible, that killed his spark. In this span, the music changed heavily, back to rapping well, and eventually more melodic cuts that were deep and meant more than a hook saying the same words over and over and your phone number. Taking that long and disappearing the way he did could kill anyone's career, and for Mike, it most certainly did, having the sound of music change in his absence. Stunt number three, royalties. One thing you have to understand about success in anything is that everyone has a different view of what success is. To you, $1 billion is what you'll take out of life and be happy. To someone else, $1 million is more than enough for them. When you have professionals that reach a certain level, they all have different goals that may not align with the expectations we have for them. Because of the hits Mike Jones created and was a part of over the years, he could just sit back and make what I'm assuming is respectable money. I don't think Mike Jones ever wanted to be the best lyricist or poet rapper, or even calling himself the king. He really didn't care about what anyone felt because he was making cool money year after year from those songs and albums while fighting legally to get paid even more off his music. When you're in that position, it can cause you to take too much time off and become a shadow in the background, but it will cost you your fans becoming older and being attracted to different artists. Many people say Mike Jones fell off, and that's partly true. Musically, I don't think anyone would deny that Mike Jones fell off, but in life, he was still making his royalties and investing them into other ventures. Because he reached that number in his head that he'd leave the game for, everything else was icing on the cake. All in all, like mentioned, Mike Jones should be at least Jeezy status right now, or even Rick Ross. Not anything personal about them, but the way he climbed to the top of the Southern Music Mountain with the speed he did, he should be a guy more remembered in hip-hop and not be still trying to drop a third album almost 20 years later. It's almost guaranteed to be a flop, and further shows why, for these reasons, his growth was stunted. It's your boy JC Stunted Growth, and I'm out.